So welcome to day five, everyone. I'm glad you're here. Without any further ado, we'll be starting with Fabian Ritz, who will be telling us about towards ecosystem management from greedy reinforcement learning. Fabian, the floor is all yours.
Well, thank you. And depending on the time zone, good morning, everybody. And this talk is on reinforcement learning. I will come to that again. First of all, I would like to point out Felix Hohenstein, my second co-author, did a great job in putting all the results together for my crazy ideas. And he's actually an undergraduate student, so thanks, Felix. So about reinforcement learning, for the moment, it's enough if you just think of it as this sequential decision-making where an agent continuously chooses action in an environment and eventually changes something in the environment. However, he will receive a reward signal and some observation with the updated environment state. And using this model of reinforcement learning, DeepMind successfully solved StarCraft II last year. And this is not just another computer game or something, but I found this to be really impressive, since real-time strategy games need some sort of long-term balance. And you have some resources, you can either spend them on your economy, so you gather more resources, or you spend them on your army to crush your opponent. And to keep such a long-term balance for like 30 or 40 minute games, I think that was pretty impressive. So I asked myself, can we perhaps use this outside of video games, but create a balance, perhaps an infinite balance, in some sort of a closed ecosystem? And here we are at chasing and fleeing unicycles. In a predator prey scenario, for myself, I'd like to think of the predator as a shark and the prey as some sort of little fish, but you can make them whatever you want them to be. That's just like what fits you the most. In our scenario, we will train the predator with reinforcement learning, namely DQN, and we will reward the predator only for catching prey, nothing else. We don't want to introduce any bias or something like that. And our prey agents will be controlled by static algorithms, such as simply flee or avoids, and they will simply try to not get caught. Well, it didn't quite work out in this case, but so you get an idea. But as we heard yesterday in a pretty exciting keynote, we need to add reproduction, so all the funny stuff that we are looking after can actually emerge. And we chose that our prey may spawn a copy of itself after some end steps and if no predator is nearby. So in this case, we will see one agent which will replicate after some steps, and it will then also replicate if no predator is nearby. Obviously, we don't have a predator here. As for the actions, we need to know that our environment is a little bit more complicated than the usual grid worlds. So we sort of simulated water friction or whatever friction you need, depending on what your agents actually are. We have elastic collisions, meaning the agents cannot overlap, but will bump sort of like snooker or that, just with lower elasticity, so some energy is lost. And we have a moment of inertia. And this means for our agent to move to the desired goal over here, he needs to, first of all, change his orientation because now he's facing upwards. And then apply some force, because just changing your orientation doesn't move you anywhere. So he actually accelerates in the direction he's facing. And this is no grid world, so he needs to do so for multiple steps. Judging this, I guess this must be some 10 steps or something like that. And the observation it receives, we implemented something like a LiDAR system. We are not training on raw pixels, but with some sort of LiDAR. And coming from this agent, he sees there is some other agent of type 2, type 2 representing this is not going to eat you. It has a distance of 9, an angle of minus 30 degree, meaning he's right to our agent. And this agent has an orientation of 0 degree. Right behind our agent, there's also another agent with type 1, indicating, well, I might get eaten if I stay here too long. And distance is 12, which is a little bit farther than this one. The angle of this agent is 180 degree. Telling this agent the shark is right behind him, and the orientation of the predator or shark here is 90 degree, meaning it's facing upwards. We have another agent here, but it's out of view as seen from this agent. So we have, formally speaking, a partial observable Markov decision process. It's all a little bit complicated here. And for things to work, we needed a two-stage training process. In the first stage, it was just about getting our predator to learn how to hunt. And for this, we put him into an environment with slow, non-reproducing prey. Actually, you can see the prey speed increasing over time, as the red line indicates. On the x-axis, we have the training progress. And on the y-axis, we have sort of the prey speed and the reward. And on the second stage, we taught the predator when to hunt. And in this case, we had full speed reproducing prey. So here reproduction comes in. We have very little prey in the beginning, which needs to spare. And the prey is always moving at full speed. And you can see on the reward axis here that reward in the second environment is much more sparse. And so this is much more difficult to learn. And as you can see from the training episodes, we took the very same agent from the first to the second training stage without resetting his weights. So this was some sort of handcrafted curriculum learning. And I need to get into a little bit more detail here because this is actually important. The input was a concatenation of not only one current observation, but some sort of concatenated past observations here. So currently we might be at time step T, and we also added T minus one, which is the time step before, and T minus two, which is also one step before. And this is necessary if you have some observations like this, because otherwise you might not judge where are the other agents coming from and where are they going. Same problem with Pong, by the way, so this is nothing new for DQN, but we will have the trace length as a hyperparameter, which is pretty important. And as we are on Alive here, I would say this is some sort of a short-term memory, actually. And something that Q-learning does is discounting future rewards. And future rewards to discount is something you learn from experience. So what comes into play here is the long-term planning with experience. So like the planning capabilities of a predator, you might think of that. I don't want to explain the Bellman updates here. Just look it up if you haven't seen it already, but there's this factor gamma, which dictates how strongly the future rewards are actually taken into account, how far-sighted will our agent act. And we have a lot of results, but I think this is the most interesting one. So we have a lot of numbers here. And what I want to point out is we actually did a hyperparameter search on gamma, on the future rewards. And on the x-axis, you have the trace length, how much past information. Both values start off very small here and increase as we move to the upper right. And we have two very distinct areas with a sharp border here. And in this area where the agent is very foresighted, looking at the caught prey per episode, we see the predator does not catch any prey at all. In the very opposite direction, if we have a very short-sighted predator, meaning low gamma, and he does not see much in the past, he acts very like a greedy predator, always eating the first agent, the first prey agent, which is there, meaning he gets a reward of one. And we can see on the reproductions that this single prey agent has no chance to reproduce. So he gets eaten immediately, leaving the predator with, well, he can't do anything at all and is on a diet, something like that. No? And there is this in-between area, which is actually where we want the predator to act. And we see there is some balance between acting foresighted and handling the past. This is where we're actually targeting. So I believe how to explain these areas. There is not being too far-sighted, but since our neural network has fixed capabilities, this was just too much information when giving him like a trace length of 80 past steps and letting him predict the next some 100 rewards. This is really a lot. And on the opposite, I don't believe that this is too few information since the predator can hunt, but he just is forced to act too short-sighted since gamma dictates him, well, don't consider the future rewards, just eat and it's okay. So I have a demo here of our strongest reinforcement learning predator. The predator's up here and just waiting for the reproductions to happen. And once there are three or four of the prey agents, he starts hunting. You can see his handling is far from perfect, but it's working all right, I guess. or at least good enough. And the same here, he can't move out, but he gets away as far as possible. So the prey agents start to reproduce, and once there are four, he starts hunting. And yeah, I pretty much believe that this would go on forever. Of course, we tickle with all the parameters, and you can look that up in the paper. But to sum things up, I would say, yes, reinforcement learning can achieve sustainable behavior. I'm not sure whether this is a closed ecosystem as you find it in the literature, but it's as closed as we could get. And I want to point out, we did no reward shaping here indicating how to act. It's just if you eat, you get a reward. If you don't eat, you get no reward. And everything else emerged. What we did was we presented the reinforcement learning agent a suitable amount of past and future information, and we did so in a multi-step training process. And as some reviewers correctly pointed out, this is not necessarily how natural systems work, but I believe it's pretty useful to solve some human-made problems. And if I got you interested, please have a look at the full paper, because we have a lot of evaluations. I couldn't show them all here. We have different prey behavior. We also implemented Boyd's algorithm for swarming prey. And of course, we have some baseline, some handcrafted predator strategies. And of course, we all beat them. But that's not too interesting for A-Life, I guess. So thanks for your attention. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Fabian. Any questions for Fabian?
Yeah, I have a question.
Go ahead.
So, first of all, congratulations for your work, Fabian.
Thanks.
And second, it's a curiosity, or maybe related to future work, but have you considered the same situation, but with also prey reproducing and changing the ecosystem in a different way? You have considered a scenario where the preys are able to reproduce, but the predators are a fixed number.
Correctly, yes.
It would be more challenging to consider a scenario where both predators and prey can reproduce and have different oscillations.
Yes, correctly. We started off with a single predator scenario here, because what happens if you introduce multiple predators is you actually end up with a tragedy of the commons problem. Like if there are two predators and you have the decision to eat or to starve, we didn't feature predator starvation here. I think we need to do that. You end up with a tragedy of the commons, and we have a lot of these problems in real life. And these are not easy to overcome. Actually, tragedy of the commons problems usually are treated in very, very simple grid worlds. So yes, this is just the first step, and I think a lot of future work, and I hope it will turn out well. I can't tell you right now, because it's really complicated.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions for our speaker?
I could ask one. So, mm-hmm. This looks like very biologically, in the sense that those systems have already evolved, and typically when a prey spawns, it's like not one offspring, but it sets out, I don't know, even 10,000 potential new offspring at once. And on the other hand, the population size and growth rate and reproduction rate of predators is significantly lower, typically their strategy. And also in human systems, I think that if you are looking at the system that has existed for a long time, maybe you should or could think that it is already one that has evolved sort of in a natural way and is already a little bit like this kind of imbalance. Oh, not imbalance, but this kind of structure and dynamics that you showed, that it's already built in there, like evolutionarily. So maybe keep that in mind if it's an established system that you then try to look at.
All right, thanks.
Okay, before we switch to our second speaker, just a point of clarification. I think it may be difficult for everyone to switch back and forth between Zoom and Slack. So why don't we, if there are multiple questions, please